I want to thank CEE for giving me the opportunity to talk about our work here. You can see that I changed my title to a cooler one because I took my academic hat and put on my cool Recoid hat. Talking about Recoid, actually, I will show a few pictures. This is old days. I was actually one of the five Chinese students, first time invited by RSI to come in 1985. And actually, we besides all the hard work we did, I was at NIH. We also actually had some really amazing activities. I was showing in the lower left corner, we're actually on the South Lawn of sort of a ceremony welcoming Chinese president by President Reagan. And the other one is we're in actually USS Hyman Rickover at the Norfolk Navy Base. So more importantly, what I got out of RSI, besides all the friends and everything, is actually I also learned about science. So this is the first project I did at NIH. I have to say this is the first ever English writing I ever done. And of course, first ever science writing I ever done in any language. So it was a quite amazing experience. As you can see, 30-some years later, I'm still actually working on the brain. Talking about the brain, we are reaching this age that is really challenging. It's the challenge of the age, as our population basically is drastically moving towards the age range that many of the age-dependent neurodegenerative disease start hitting, especially the baby boomer. So I basically put a number there, about 70 million people are gonna reach the age 65 and older by 2030. So why that's important? Because that's basically gonna set out a looming crisis globally for Alzheimer's disease as well as other related dementia. So I put in, basically the Alzheimer's disease affects about 1 in 10 for people 65 and older. And right now it's about 5.7 million in the US, about 50 million worldwide. But then it's gonna double and triple. By 2050, we're gonna have 130 million people around the world has Alzheimer's disease. So basically the risk factor are many. So there's, of course, age is the number one. And there's genetics, which we'll talk about. There's gender, women is about twice as many as men, but women live longer, that's one of the reasons. And also there's a lifestyle, such as comorbidity like diabetes and smoking. And so we all know the symptoms of Alzheimer's, right? The memory loss, behavior changes, but there's just this inexorable deterioration towards eventually loss of language, loss of ability to take care of themselves, loss of ability to think. So patient usually lasts about 8 to 10 years. So the thing about Alzheimer's is so devastating, not just to the patient's health, but also to the society in terms of the cost. So every patient needs about 3 people to take care of them. So right now there are 15 million people take care of Alzheimer's patients, even though we don't have any disease-modifying therapies. But that translates into the cost about 1% of the world GDP is toward taking care of Alzheimer's disease. So that means that there's about $260 billion today spent on Alzheimer's disease, but that's projected to go up to more than $1 trillion in about, by 2050. So that's actually potentially more than our defense cost. So so this is a really sort of a huge medical, but also a societal problem that I think many people try to address. So, but what about the biology of Alzheimer's disease? So if you look into the brain, as Alois Alzheimer, the German psychiatrist and pathologist did in 1906, for the very first patient, it's a, I show it there, it's August Dieter. At the time, actually, he thought this is extremely rare condition. People rarely live above, 50s. And as a matter of fact, August Dieter died at the age of 55. So pretty much what we know about Alzheimer is what Alzheimer described in terms of pathology. So you see a neuron on the left side that is dying. You see actually even in the low power, you show this sort of atrophy of the brain region, especially the region involving memory. And you see the neuron that actually start having these fibrillary tangles inside them. They start losing their process. And then you see this red amyloid plaque. These are abnormal protein accumulation in the people's brain actually about 10 years before they even get Alzheimer's disease. And then you see these sort of blue-purple cells surrounding them, and they're the immune cells of the brain, especially those so-called microglia. So for the longest time, people are focusing on these plaque and tangle. They look horrible, and they are. But some of the therapy directed against the amyloid, despite companies spend hundreds of billions of dollars, is not working well so far, at least in clinical trials. So but the microglia, these immune cells in the brain, become sort of a new focus. One of the reasons these cells actually get into the brain before the blood-brain barrier closed, and they basically reside in the brain to do the, what the innate immune cell will do in the periphery. So in the bottom, I show you, these guys has actually a day job. their day job is to take care of the synaptic connections, make sure the brain can learn. So these are very important day job. But in a condition where there's a damage, where this brain is hit, you know, in traumatic brain injury or in Alzheimer's disease, they start to react. And the reactive, you know, microglia, they can do things like phagocytosis, they eat up the debris, you know, clean up things. But they could also overreact and secrete some of the molecules that could potentially damaging to the brain. So the age-long question really is, are these good cops or bad cops, right? I mean, it could be like a mixture of both. That's the question. So for the longest time, people cannot decide whether these are good things or bad things, and a lot of people just sort of dismiss it as very downstream events that we cannot do much about. However, the triumph of human genetics basically pointing at a whole different direction. So this is the landscape of genetics of Alzheimer's disease. So on the y-axis is talk about how much risk you have Alzheimer. On the x-axis is how much these individual gene variants are in our population. So on the very left upper corner are the familial Alzheimer's disease. These are less than 5% of Alzheimer's disease. They run in family, they get very early. And all these genes, when they mutate, they seem to overproduce this amyloid plaque, okay? But then the things on the bottom are the ones that involving late onset Alzheimer's disease, the run-of-the-mill, the most common form of Alzheimer's disease in our population. So for the longest time, we know the number one gene is APOE, APOE4, okay, which is, you know, very actually contribute about threefold the risk to Alzheimer's disease. You have two copies, that's actually more than 12-fold. So APOE4 is a little bit hard for us to understand because it's a lipid binding protein. It's sort of in many different cells throughout the body. But then since 2012, 2013, the game changed, because there are a whole other group of genes start showing up. The number two is TREM2, I show it there, and there are a whole bunch of genes in the lower right corner. So all these genes seem to be pointing at one very concrete idea that what could be going on in Alzheimer's brain. That is that almost all these genes, the vast majority of these genes, are expressed in immune cells in the brain, so-called microglia, okay? So that actually all of a sudden get people say, ha, these guys may not be just a downstream, you know, bystander or the late events. They could actually involve in conferring the early risk for getting Alzheimer's disease. So as I said, the number two gene for the Alzheimer's disease, this gene called TREM2, is actually sitting on the membrane interacting with another protein called DAP12. So all the mutations that increase the risk for Alzheimer's disease are outside the membrane, and they seem to involve in binding to the ligands that you know, somehow signaling through TREM2. Importantly, a lot of these so-called microglia Alzheimer genes are actually somehow working with TREM2. So they seem to be somehow working the pathway, either make the pathway work better or work worse. As a matter of fact, some of the variants are protective. Okay, so basically now people start thinking human genetics is telling something really interesting to us. Not only the cell type is important, they seem to have a pathway that somehow work together to increase or decrease risk of Alzheimer's disease. So we got really interested in this question. When we start working on this question, a lot of people basically are trying to say how TREM2 is, you know, not working and make the risk of Alzheimer's disease going up. You know, they study in cells or study in animal models. We ask the opposite question. We say, can we somehow tweak the TREM2 function? In this case, can we boost TREM2 function? And what does that do to the, you know, mouse models with Alzheimer's disease? I won't talk about this, you know, if we actually have some results. So I have one postdoc and one MD PhD student. They did this work that's recently published. So basically, we tried to study how can we potentially boost the TREM2 in the brain of a mouse model Alzheimer's disease. So the tool we used is this large DNA transgenesis. So we took this really big piece of human DNA. So these actually are human DNA carried endogenous TREM2 gene we put in the mouse model. The nice thing with this kind of a large DNA called the BAC is that they have essentially all the bells and whistles for the human TREM2 so that it regulates accurately in the brain in the mouse model. We did this in a very sophisticated way because on that big DNA carries some other TREM-like genes, you know, besides TREM2, and they could interfere with the way you interpret the genetic data. So we actually delete all the other genes, just leave TREM2 intact. And we show that the regulation of this gene in the mouse brain is very accurate. It's only in the microglia, and it goes up right around the plaque. Okay, that's what you expected. So what I'm gonna show you is just one critical piece of data, or two critical pieces of data from this study. So what we did is we crossed the TREM2 mice with two different Alzheimer mouse model, the so-called Alzheimer mouse model, because they overproduce those amyloid plaque. So these mice has lots of plaque, they have a big, you know, immune activation in the brain, and they also have memory loss. So when we cross these two to the two Alzheimer model, on the top, is the green is the microglia. So you can see these angry looking microglia with short process surrounding this, you know, horrible looking red plaque. And then in the bottom is the AD mouse model where we dialed up the TREM2. Now you look at it, you can tell there's a big difference, right? These microglia seem to be a little bit more cool, like ricoids, and they're surrounding the plaque and they're reducing the plaque. Okay, not only they're surrounding them well, they're reducing them. And moreover, we see, you know, the neurons seem to do better. And importantly, we also did molecular profiling to show there's a real reprogramming. Okay, some of the genes go up, some of the genes go down, and they seem to increase the ability of the microglia to eat. And then when we looked at the memory task for two of these Alzheimer mouse models, they seem to completely restored. Okay, so this is actually really interesting. We manipulate a human disease-related gene by boosting its normal function. Not only it completely changed the way plaque behave, they also actually can able to restore the behavior. So this is a very interesting finding. We call this reprogramming because of some of the molecular finding. I won't have time to explain the detail of that, but I basically ask a cartoonist to potentially explain that with a cartoon. So basically, you can imagine on the left side is the microglia in the Alzheimer mouse brain or Alzheimer brain trying really hard to put out this fire in the brain that's burning the neurons, right? And they're not doing enough of a good job, but almost done. Yeah, but on the right is if you can somehow tweak these, you know, genes and boosting certain pathway, maybe reducing other pathway in the microglia, then you get these super efficient expert firefighters. Right, you need a few of them, and they do a better job, and maybe cause less collateral damage. So of course, you know, this kind of research, you know, like this, is really going to, I think, facilitate people's interest as well as, you know, interest of the pharmaceutical company to potentially start looking for small molecules or other type of therapy or even cell-based therapy to actually target the microglia to try to reprogram it. This is something that we're interested to do too. So can we, like, reprogramming the microglia have the same signature as we did genetically? And then once we have them, we have to go into the, you know, identify molecule that can go into in vivo in the animal model. So we're going to test our, you know, little mouse models. And if that works well, we can go back to the patients. So talking, I just have two more slides to tell you that talking about this kind of study, for the longest time, actually the challenge, the bottleneck, has been in the in vivo part, in the preclinical study. Because we're talking about mouse brain, you know, in old mouse brain, right? And then we all know that the neurons are very complex. So human has 80 billion neurons, mouse has 80 million neurons of at least 10,000 or more different type. So, but if you look at the Alzheimer brain on the lower upper left, the way the neuron degenerate in the brain, the certain type degenerate, but they die randomly in different part of the brain. And they die by gradually losing their process. So it's very, very difficult to study. Imagine in the Amazon jungle, one type of tree is randomly dying in the jungle. You can either take a picture from the satellite, like an MRI, you're not going to see very clearly which is dying, or you can parachute someone into the jungle, but he can only look at 20, 30 trees, not millions of trees we should look at. So basically, and the current genetic labeling tools actually can label one type of neuron, but these branches are right overlap each other. We cannot see the process. We basically just see the field of green. So actually, we have my lab had two brain initiative projects to develop this new neural technology, allow us to actually look at the detailed neuronal morphology, but we look at tens and thousands of them. So this is actually the type of neuron that die in Alzheimer's brain. Now we can label 10,000 of them. When you zoom in, you can look at every single connection, both the inputs and outputs. As a matter of fact, we're developing a brain-wide imaging tool. Brain-wide imaging tool allow us to actually image about 30,000 of these type of neuron and image them brain-wide. And then we're working actually both with neuroanatomists as well as the computer scientists to develop ways to interpret this huge amount of data. Once we have this kind of tool, it will allow us to look at the selected type of neuron that dies in certain disease and do so brain-wide. So this will really help to facilitate, I think, study the brain disease, and also drug discovery. So I think that is pretty much my talk. I just want to thank people who've done the work with me in the lab, except the dog, and also the the institutes who and the foundation who actually found our work. Thank you. Oh, good. Any questions? Yes.
I probably missed part of the presentation, which I was very impressed by. But how do your brain map the neurons? I didn't quite understand.
Oh, how do we map it?
The test, how do you do it, yes.
You mean the last two slides I was talking about?
Yes.
Okay, well, I don't have time to go into detail, but the way is that we have to somehow label the neuron sparsely. Okay, so if you label 100%, then you label all the trees right on top of each other. So if we can label one type of neuron, okay, and then so imagine that we label one type of tree in the Amazon jungle red. They still overlap each other, so you see a sea of red. But if we only label 1 to 5% of them red of that type, all of a sudden you can see everything. So if you have a really good microscope from the space, you can see the whole jungle, but you can have the resolution of single leaf. That's what we actually able to do now with this new technology. So, yes.
Yes. In the TREM2 mice, in early age, were there phenotypic changes?
No. We actually did transcriptomics. We did electrophysiology and behavior. The normal mice that upregulate TREM2, they are completely normal. So, yeah. Thanks.